Well, if you'd open your Bible to the book of Daniel, chapter 8, book of Daniel, our practice as a church is to pick a book of the Bible and to walk through it. We do this at varying speeds. Some books we go through more slowly, looking at just a few verses at a time. Others we go through more quickly, looking at larger sections. That's what we're doing with Daniel. We have three more messages. They are not able, because of the length of the passages, to be message of great detail or depth, but I hope, my hope is that these messages will make Daniel a more friendly place to anyone that hears these messages. I mentioned last week, Daniel is one of those books in the Bible that people run away from. It's kind of like the spooky house at the end of the street that nobody plays around, and you just move on quickly, shuffle past it with your eyes averted. That can be like the second half of Daniel, but it doesn't need to be. It doesn't need to be. Actually, if we see it rightly, when the sun comes out, as it were, and we look at it with a different perspective, we can see it actually has great value to us. It's not nearly as spooky, as frightening or as confusing as it might initially appear to be. So my hope is that as we read these chapters, we gain some familiarity where you could study them on your own and not feel lost or confused, or maybe never study them at all. So like I did last week, I want to read through the whole chapter. I'm going to read swiftly, but again, I think we need to hear the whole chapter read so that we can kind of take it in its entirety. And then we'll jump in to study it together. So let's read Daniel chapter 8, verse 1. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared to me, Daniel, after that which appeared to me at the first. And I saw in the vision, and when I saw, I was in Susa, the capital, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in the vision, and I was at the Ulai Canal. And I raised my eyes and saw, and behold, a ram standing on the bank of the canal. It had two horns, and both horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher one came up last. I saw the ram charging westward and northward and southward. No beast could stand before him, and there was no one who could rescue from his power. He did as he pleased and became great. And as I was considering, behold, a male goat came from the west across the face of the whole earth without touching the ground. And the goat had a conspicuous horn between his eyes. He came to the ram with the two horns, which I had seen standing in the bank of the canal. And he ran at him in his powerful wrath. I saw him come close to the ram, and he was enraged against him and struck the ram and broke his two horns. And the ram had no power to stand before him, but he cast him down to the ground and trampled on him. And there was no one who could rescue the ram from his power. The goat became exceedingly great, but when he was strong, the great horn was broken. And instead of it, there came up four conspicuous horns towards the four winds of heaven. Out of one of them came a little horn, which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. It grew great even to the host of heaven, and some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and trampled on them. It became great, even as great as the prince of the host, and the regular burnt offering was taken away from him, and the place of his sanctuary was overthrown, and a host will be given over to it together with the regular burnt offering because of transgression. And it will throw truth to the ground, and it will act and prosper. Then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to the one who spoke, "For how long is the vision concerning the regular burnt offering, the transgression that makes desolate, and the giving over of the sanctuary and host to be trampled underfoot?" And he said to me, "For 2,300 evenings and mornings. Then the sanctuary shall be restored to its rightful state." When I, Daniel, had seen the vision, I sought to understand it. And behold, there stood before me one having the appearance of a man. And I heard a man's voice between the banks of the Ulai, and it called, "Gabriel, make this man understand the vision." So he came near where I stood, and when he came, I was frightened and fell on my face. But he said to me, "Understand, O son of man, that the vision is for the time of the end." And when he had spoken to me, I fell into a deep sleep with my face to the ground, but he touched me and made me stand up. He said, "Behold, I will make known to you what shall be at the latter end of the indignation. For it refers to the appointed time of the end. As for the ram that you saw with the two horns, these are the kings of Media and Persia, and the goat is the king of Greece, and the great horn between his eyes is the first king. As for the horn that was broken, in place of which four others arose, four kingdoms shall arise from his nation, but not with his power. And at the latter end of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their limit, a king of bold face, one who understands riddles, shall arise. His power shall be great, but not by his own power, and he shall cause fearful destruction and shall succeed in what he does and destroy mighty men and the people who are the saints. By his cunning he shall make deceit prosper under his hand, and in his own mind he shall become great. Without warning he shall destroy many, and he shall even rise up against the prince of princes, and he shall be broken, but by no human hand. The vision of the evenings and the mornings that has been told is true, but seal up the vision, for it refers to many days from now. And I, Daniel, was overcome and lay sick for some days, and then I arose and went about the king's business, but I was appalled by the vision and did not understand it. I am one of the worst people that I know with directions. I'm sure there are people worse than me, but I haven't met very many of them yet. I would like to meet them because I would feel much better about myself if I did, but I have not met them yet. When we first got married, driving was one of the most frequent conflicts Lori and I would have. One point, which she still reminds me to this day, we started driving to a friend's house, and after we'd been driving for a few minutes, she turned to me and said, "Do you know where you're going?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Well, why are we driving if you don't know where you're going?" And I couldn't answer that question. I had some optimistic sense that I'll just somehow find my way there eventually. Well, that continues to happen. Still to this day, my friends have to tell me how to get places that I've been to countless times. Now, remind me again, is it a right and then a left? I don't know where I'm going. So what greatly helps me in my ineptitude is looking at maps from a bird's eye perspective. Because when I'm on the road, I am lost. I can't remember things, landmarks. Aaron told me the other day that there's a new bridge on the east side of Round Rock that I've driven under countless times and apparently driven over with him multiple times. He said, "We've driven over this bridge together, you and I, remember just the other day." Really? It's done? Yeah. It's, remember just the other day we drove over? Wow, I didn't notice that at all. That's what it's like driving with me. So if you get in a car with me, you get in the driver's seat, okay? I'll talk with you, you'll drive, we'll get to where we're supposed to go. It'll be a marvelous situation. But I need a map. I need to kind of see, okay, this road connects over here, and this road connects over here. I see how this works. And if I can keep that map in my head, I do much, much better. Well, the same is true for the book of Daniel and for chapter 8, and really for history. If we can keep a heavenly perspective, the journey will go much, much better for us. We will know in the large scheme of things where we are. Now, when we're in the thick of it, we might still feel lost. We might feel like the territory is unfamiliar. We don't recognize the landmarks. But if we can go back to a heavenly perspective, a God's eye view, we'll make the journey endurable. Especially when we go through those dark valleys and difficult times. Daniel chapter 8 is basically God giving Daniel, and through Daniel, God's people, a God's eye view of the coming centuries and some of the key moments that are going to happen. One of the things we notice that's distinct from the previous chapter, where God also looks ahead into the future, is he's much more explicit in this chapter. He identifies symbols with named empires. He says, "This is going to happen. This kingdom is going to rise up. Let me give you its name, Daniel." So right from the beginning in Daniel chapter 8, we get the sense that God wants to give Daniel and his people his own all-knowing perspective. He doesn't give them every detail. He doesn't describe every tree, every landmark, but he gives them a big picture perspective. Here's what's going to happen. You need my perspective to endure the days that are coming. And the same is true for us. We need a heavenly perspective to endure the earthly road we're called to walk. We need a heavenly perspective to endure the raging nations of this earth that we're called to walk through and walk with. Just like Daniel, just like those that followed him in the centuries after Babylon, we need God's perspective, and we actually find that the road that they walked in those centuries is very similar to the road that Jesus and the New Testament writers describe for Christians today. It's not all that different. There's a lot of similarities, and so we need this same perspective. God has not left us without a roadmap for the road we will walk. He has shown us and declared to us, here's what it's going to look like. Like, here's the big picture. Here's the major things you're going to face. And it's to our own peril if we neglect the benefit of gazing at that map. It would have been for Daniel, and it will be for us. Now, the map might be alarming. It is for Daniel. When you look at it and you see, wow, that's frightening. That's where the road of history is going to take us. That's concerning. That's scary. But if you know the map, where it goes, and that you'll have to face it, at least you won't be caught off guard, caught unawares. You'll be aware that these things are coming. That seems to be what God is determined to do with Daniel. Now, just a couple of overarching thoughts about this story, and then we'll try to apply it to ourselves. First of all, we want to notice that, as I said, these two animals, this ram and this goat, that are present in this vision, unlike previous visions, are explicitly named in the interpretation. Did you notice that? Where in this passage, God says that. So there's going to be this ram. He sees a ram in this vision. And ram's just trampling everything, apparently. Just this outraged ram, just looking for conquest everywhere he goes. North and south and everywhere. Westward, northward and southward in verse 4. It's just no beast could stand before this ram. Does whatever he pleases, which is language the Bible uses of God. So he has almost a divine kind of power on earth. He does whatever he wants, this ram does. But then, surprisingly, a goat comes with this single horn. And he tramples on the ram. The one that appeared to be invincible is crushed. And then God says explicitly later in the interpretation, these are two empires that are coming, Daniel. This is during the Babylonian Empire under Belshazzar. And God predicts, okay, there's a nation coming. It's sort of a double nation. You notice the two horns. One's higher than the other. It's the Medo-Persian Empire. They were sort of linked. Persia was greater than Media. They were kind of together. They had rulers of both lineages that ruled over the kingdom at different times. And so this is this ram that tramples everything. And it did. It trampled everything. It destroyed Babylon. It defeated Babylon the Great, this Persian Empire. And for a while, it seemed to have absolute dominion. But then the Greek Empire rose. You notice God says there's going to be a first king, and he's going to be like a great, powerful horn on the head of this goat. Well, even a little knowledge of history allows us to say, boy, it's not difficult to know who that is. This chapter is actually quite traceable in history because the Medo-Persian Empire was conquered by Alexander the Great, who ruled over the Middle East with incredible speed. You notice the word about the goat, as it says, he runs as though he's not even touching the ground. It appears to be a reference to speed, and that certainly was the case with Alexander the Great. He conquered, even by the time he was 33, he was grieved that there was no more part of the world to conquer. And like Alexander the Great, it says this horn's going to be broken, apparently abruptly. That's exactly what happened to him. At a young age, he died abruptly. And exactly like happened in history, there were four generals that eventually took divided parts of his kingdom. You notice the four horns. Four kingdoms shall arise from his nation in verse 22, but not with his power. And then you notice this little horn that's referenced both in the dream and in the interpretation. Well, out of one of those kingdoms, a Syrian ruler named Antiochus was kind of developed and began to rule in the land of Jerusalem. It says that it grew up even to the glorious land. That's probably a reference to Jerusalem. So this story, with the benefit of hindsight, proves to be incredibly accurate. God is declaring in advance, Daniel, here's what's going to happen. The Persian Empire is going to come. It's going to seem invincible. And then there's going to be this other empire, and it's really going to seem invincible. And this initial king is going to be overwhelmingly powerful, but then he's going to be broken. And there's going to be four kings that arise after him. That's exactly what happened. And then out of them, there's going to be a little king, and he's going to grow great, especially in the glorious land, and he's going to do all kinds of terrible things to God's people, and he's going to fight against God. Well, it's almost difficult not to identify the name of that ruler as Antiochus. Now, you've read this passage. It says that this little horn, representative of a king, is going to be great, even as great as the prince of hosts, that apparently he's going to hate God such that the burnt offering of the temple is going to be taken away. He's going to take a host of people captive in verse 12. And then he's going to act and prosper for a period of time. And then later on in the interpretation, it says he's going to throw truth to the ground. Deceit will prosper in his hand. He will destroy many, and eventually he will be destroyed. Now, let me read you, because I know this is a more obscure part of history. But again, as I said last week, the Bible is inspired in what it says and what it chooses not to say. And in this case, this description is so clearly fulfilled in this tyrant that persecuted God's people, it's actually part of the benefit to hear how accurate this description was. Listen to what one commentator says about this man Antiochus, a Syrian ruler. He grew out of the Greek Empire about the 2nd century BC. So this is 200 years before the coming of Jesus. This is kind of a long quote, but I think it's valuable for us. Listen to this. Antiochus had invaded Egypt at that time, and on his way home, he came to Jerusalem, where his lackey, Menelaus, the highest bidder for the high priesthood, handed over a hoard of temple treasures, including sacred furniture, to him, so that he carted off, so it was said, 1,800 talents, and this was only the half of it. For while Antiochus had still been in Egypt, Jason, a previously ousted high priest and Menelaus's rival, suddenly attacked Jerusalem, but with only temporary success. Antiochus, however, saw this as a revolt. Hence, on his 169, that's 169 BC, his 169 visit, he looted the temple, but also carried out a horrific bloodbath. Worse was on its way. In 167 BC, he sent his chief tax collector, Apollonius, to Jerusalem, and pillage, massacre, and ruin were the orders of the day. Now Antiochus insisted on a forced paganization program meant to corrupt and decimate every aspect of Israel's faith and practice. This scheme called for the abolition of the temple cult and the observance of the law and the substitution of pagan cults. The observance of all Jewish ordinances, in particular those relating to the Sabbath and circumcision, was prohibited on pain of death. In every town in Judea, sacrifice was to be offered to the heathen gods. Overseers were sent everywhere to see that the royal command was carried out, and where the people did not comply willingly, they were obliged to do so by force. Once a month, a check was made, and whoever was found with the scroll of the Torah or had had a child circumcised was put to death. On 15th Kislev of December 167 BC, a heathen altar was built in Jerusalem on the great altar of burnt offering, and on 25th Kislev, the first heathen sacrifice was offered on it. That sacrifice was offered to Olympian Zeus, to whom the Jerusalem temple had been dedicated. And Dale Ralph Davis, the commentator, adds, a little taste of Antichrist ahead of time. The reason I reference that history is to point out how incredibly accurate God's prediction to Daniel is. This man that's described here in prophecy fulfilled that description almost, I mean, literally to the letter, right? This little horn, it says in verse 11, will become great, even as great as the prince of hosts. The regular burnt offering was taken away. The place of the sanctuary was overthrown. A host, that'd be a host of people, will be given over to it with the regular burnt offering and because of transgression. It will throw truth to the ground. It will act and prosper, this little horn. And then we read later that when the interpretation comes, his power shall be great, he shall cause fearful destruction, shall succeed in what he does, he will destroy mighty men, the people who are the saints. By his cunning he shall make deceit prosper under his hand. Without warning he shall destroy many, he shall even rise up against the prince of princes. He shall be broken by no human hand. God is basically giving Daniel and God's people through the centuries a map of what's going to happen. Here's what's going to happen. Two major empires and an atrocious tyrant that's going to persecute, butcher, and try to paganize God's people. That's what's going to happen. That's what's coming. And we notice there's an emphasis. The fact that these are shared in dream and then interpreted, we want to notice the little interruption here when Gabriel is told by a voice. I think we're to presume that's the Lord. Gabriel, make this man understand. Daniel's trying to understand who's the goat, who's the ram, what's the little horn. And God wants to make this explicit. As I said, the Bible is inspired in what it says explicitly and in those moments when it doesn't say. The point here is God wanted his people through those centuries between Daniel, around 500 years before Christ, and the coming of Christ, to know what they were going to face. They needed a heavenly perspective, a heavenly prediction, so that they could endure. They needed that. God decided, you need to know what you're going to face so that when you're facing it, you can keep going. It's intended to be a comfort. None of this is going to be a surprise, Daniel. Painful, yes. Alarming, yes. Difficult, yes. Confusing, yes. But not surprising. Not surprising. And when we get to the New Testament, we can see, I can see why we still needed this chapter in Daniel as well. Because it reminds us that the same thing they faced, the same thing they needed, is the thing we will face and we will need as well. You wonder why didn't Daniel 8, why isn't it just a chapter that was present just for those centuries and then lost? Why do we still need to read this? Why is this still part of our Bible? Well, because the New Testament says in the same way that Antiochus and these nations troubled God's people back then, well, there's going to be nations and kings and troublers of God's people today. So having known that the sanctuary does get established in spite of all these things, that God's people endure in spite of all these things, we can take comfort and warning as well. We look at their map. And remember what they made through, and that God's used that map to strengthen and encourage them. And it causes us to remember that we have a map as well. We have a map of what's going to happen. What about us? Well, the New Testament gives a number of warnings that reflect the same kind of thing that Daniel faced. According to Jesus, this same kind of experience is going to take place until the end. And knowing that it happened historically and was predicted by God can give us comfort that God's predictions always come true and that we need this map as well. Listen to some of these passages. Matthew chapter 24, verse 7, Jesus says, "For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of the birth pains." Very explicit statement that these same kinds of raging nations is going to take place. But not only that, there's also going to be deceivers who seek explicitly to fight against God and to destroy God's people. 2 Thessalonians 2, 3-10 says, "Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come, the end times will not come, unless the rebellion comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed." Now listen to how much this man sounds like Antiochus. "The son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God." Epiphanes means the manifestation of God. "Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know that what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders, with all wicked deception for those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. And lest we think this is only a brief time at the end, John says, children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know it is the last hour. Or as Jesus says again in Matthew, see that no one leads you astray. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of the birth pains. And they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations. Listen, this is the map. It's not new. It's happened before. But he restates it to remind us what happened before will happen again. We need this map. God's maps are always accurate. They will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come. This isn't the chapter you read to convince everybody that if you just have enough faith in God, life will be healthy, wealthy, and bountiful. This is not that chapter. But it is the chapter you read if you're convinced that God's predictions always come true and that it is much better to know what is coming and to prepare for it by driving ourselves into the truth of God and his gospel and his power than it is to be surprised and shocked by these things when they come. That's why we preach Daniel 8 and not just Romans 8. That's why we preach Daniel 9 and 10, 11, 12, and not just John 3:16. We need the full counsel of God's word. We need the map. We don't just need the promises that the end will come. We also need the help of how we walk the road between now and then, and the reminder that faithful believers before the coming of Jesus, when the sanctuary was their central place of encountering God, knew that God knew what was coming and that he would preserve them through incredible difficulty. We need their reminder. They are a part of that great cloud of witnesses that Hebrews talks about. The faithful believers who endured this despicable tyrant are a part of the witnesses who cheer us on when we face the despicable tyrants that we face today. There were faithful believers before the coming of Jesus, who faithfully looked to the temple as the place to encounter God. And these raging nations and this raging despot was a great persecution to their faith. It was a great, terrible thing to see him abominate the temple and to worship their heathen gods from their sacred grounds where they would encounter God and sacrifice according to the law. We need to hear their calls to us. We knew it was coming. And God helped us to endure. Remember, things are coming as well. So what do we look to? Two points I want to make that we should prepare for and be prepared for because of the heavenly perspective God has given us. What does the map tell us? What does it tell us? Two things. First, prepare for raging nations. Prepare for raging nations. And then prepare for raging blasphemy. Prepare for raging nations. Raging nations, apparently, is the norm. Daniel, living in Babylon, would have been shocked to discover that great and mighty Babylon is going to be forgotten and these successive kings and kingdoms are going to rage. This ram is going to trample back and forth, it says, on the land. And then the goat's going to trample the ram, and then it's going to be gone, and new kings are going to rise up. The idea that nations will rise against nation is just pressed on Daniel. There will be no permanent status quo, Daniel. There will be no permanent established civilization. Nation is going to come and nation's going to go. There's going to be raging kings bent on conquest. Prepare for raging nations. And Jesus explicitly says nations will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. It means raging nations is the norm. A Christian should have a realistic perspective about peace on earth. Doesn't mean we don't want peace. Doesn't mean we don't hope for peace. Doesn't mean we don't hope that nations can work together and cheer for the time being that they do. But we shouldn't hope in or expect permanent international cooperation. That's not the expectation the Bible gives us. And we shouldn't pin all of our hopes on that permanent international cooperation, because that's not the way it was for Daniel, and it's not the way Jesus says it will be for us. Nation will rise against nation. Certainly we pray for the absence of conflict and warfare, but the Bible says that there will always be national creatures raging to and fro across the landscape. The presence of war should not decimate the faith of one following God. There is only one kingdom where war ends, and that's His. Prepare for raging nations, because no nation or ruler is permanent. We shouldn't fix our hope or our fear on a certain earthly ruler. I think this is needed in our country. I think this is needed in the evangelical church. There can at times be the sense that we desperately need an earthly political ruler to do this or that or the other thing. And should we work for that and fight for that? And should some Christians devote themselves even full time to a political process for the good of their fellow citizens? Yes, they should, absolutely. But on the other hand, if we give ourselves to such a degree to a certain earthly ruler, we need to remember, according to the Bible, every ruler is temporary. Even the greatest, most godly, God-honoring ruler in this age is temporary. Even the greatest nation on earth, the most moral nation, the most godly, God-fearing nation on earth, it's temporary. We can't pin our hope on that. We certainly shouldn't throw away our witness in order to achieve that. Nor should we fear when a despicable ruler rises. I find this to be true almost every election cycle. There's sometimes that some, even Christian teachers, they talk about this election like, this is the end. If this person is elected, do you know, this is the end. I think, well, I understand what you're trying to say, but let's relativize that a little bit. It's the next one. And if he's despicably evil, he's not going to last very long. It doesn't mean the next one's going to be better, but he's not going to be him forever or her forever. There is no permanent earthly ruler. I would not recommend Christians fight and be in animosity over great hope or great fear about a certain ruler on earth. Nations will rise against nations, kingdom against kingdoms. The horns keep sprouting and they keep being broken off. And so the church should be able to say, this isn't ultimately our hope or our fear that a certain ruler is in place. We work for better ones. We work for more godly ones. Ultimately, we know the good ones will go and the bad ones will go. Prepare for raging nations. Final point under this section. The nations don't scare God. I think it's instructive and intentional that after a chapter where the nations are described as these ferocious beasts, leopards with wings and dragons with horns and everything, in this chapter, the same nations are described as a ram and a goat. Now, not in such a way that they're not seen as aggressive and powerful, and it's not in a way to minimize their earthly power, but I think it's intentional that God switches the metaphor because, again, the point of this chapter is to give heavenly perspective. Chapter 7 emphasizes, in one way, the human perspective of these people, that they look like monsters to us. But chapter 8 includes this heavenly perspective. The powerful on earth are like petting zoo creatures from the eyes of God. There's a bit of ironic mockery here. The raging, trampling king of Medo-Persia is a ram. And the great Alexander is a goat. There's an intentional irony. You should hear a bit of the chuckle of God's people. In the midst of their fear, how does God see Alexander the Great? He's a goat. Folks, rams are meant to be sheared. Goats are meant to be milked. There's this sense of belittling. There's this sense of putting them in their place. From a human perspective, yes, they're monstrous and devouring and trampling and nothing can stand before them. From God's perspective, they're tameable in a pen. Amen. They're shearable. They eat garbage. There's this minimizing of them. And so there is this point to be made. Look, they will seem terrible to you, not minimizing their fearfulness from a human perspective, but from a divine perspective, let me give you their smallness. A ram and a goat are the greatest emperors that the world has seen to that point. The nations don't scare God. The lesson is relevant to us as well. The nations don't scare God. Kings don't scare God. Hitler didn't scare God. Stalin doesn't scare God. Current rulers don't scare God. They don't scare God. They're tameable, pettable, pennable. Fearsome to us, not to God. Prepare for raging nations and prepare for them with a heavenly perspective. Other thing we should do, prepare for raging blasphemy. Prepare for raging blasphemy. As I mentioned, there is a remarkable pickup, if I can use that word, a pickup of the language that describes Antiochus and this despicable ruler that crushed God's people between the time of Daniel and Jesus, and the language of the Antichrist and Antichrists and persecutors in the New Testament. So for the Jewish people who would be very familiar with this history, he was a sort of a prototype of the Antichrist to come. He was a model. He was maybe a first in history of a kind of antagonistic persecutor of what it'll be like for the church. Because they pick up descriptions of him and they apply that to the lawless one or the Antichrist that will attack the church in this age. And as John says, the spirit of Antichrist is already at work. So there may be a final ultimate one, but there's probably going to be a lot of people that look a lot like him. So we can glean from his destruction of God's people and hatred of God what it will look like for us to prepare for raging blasphemy. A couple things you want to notice. First of all, this kind of blasphemer is directed towards God. He hates God. Notice it mentions this, that he will be as great as the prince of hosts. And you see that where it said he will tear down the stars from heaven and trample on them? That seems to be a picture of this one that is empowered by Satan and that behind his rule, there's cosmic warfare going on. Probably the stars of heaven is a reference to angels. And that behind the evil on earth, there is an evil one who is fighting against God and fighting against his angels and even seeking to conquer God. It seems to be his desire to defeat God, to hate God. So there are going to be people on earth with power, human power, whose desire is to conquer and defeat God, to rise against the prince of the hosts. I think that's a reference to the Lord. And because they hate God, they seek to destroy any symbol of the presence of God, The burnt offering, it says, was taken away from him in verse 11. It says a host will be given over to it. I think that's a reference to him taking captive God's people. So it will be aimed at God, and it will seek to destroy God's dwelling place. Well, folks, that's going to be the same today. That spirit of Antichrist hates God, and there is no earthly temple now. But there is a church that Paul says is the dwelling place of God on earth. And so that same rage will be directed to the church. It will seek to eradicate this place where God is worshiped. It will seek to throw truth to the ground and deceive many. Jesus said, look, in that time, many will fall away. Many professing Christians who claim to believe in Jesus, they're going to fall away because following Jesus is going to be hard. In various times, in various ways, it's going to be hard because following Jesus is going to come at a cost, at a great cost it's going to come. Because there's this one who wants to deceive the saints and lead them astray and crush the place where God's dwelling is celebrated. He wants to blaspheme God and to get others to blaspheme God. And so Christians need to see on that map, okay, there's going to come times where the sanctuary of God, which is the church today, will be persecuted, will be crushed, will be trodden. And this evil will appear to have power even over the church. It will appear to have a certain dominion. It will appear that they are given over to his hand for a time. It will appear that way. From a human experience, it will seem as though the sanctuary of God on earth is being decimated. That seems to be what Jesus is saying. People are going to be falling away. That love of many, that their professed love of God, is going to grow cold. And can't we see this even in our own state, in our part of the world and country? How easy it would be to say, I'm a Christian, I believe in Jesus, until that costs you your life. And then to say, well, maybe I don't believe in him quite as much as I thought I did. And so for true Christians, this is an exhortation, as Jesus said to Peter, watch and pray so you don't fall into temptation, because temptation is going to come. You don't want to be one of those professing Christians that their love grows cold. You want to be a true saint that clings to Jesus even when it costs you something. It will seek to destroy God's dwelling place. But it's important also to remember that this blasphemy of Antiochus in those years between Daniel and Jesus, and the fact that, if you noticed in this passage, the sanctuary will be restored. Did you notice that little verse in there? It's almost buried in the passage. Now, for Daniel, the fact that there was a sanctuary to destroy at all would be surprising, because remember, he's in Babylon, and the sanctuary was already destroyed. They haven't been sent back yet at this point. So apparently, there's going to be a sanctuary that's going to be restored, and then it's going to be trampled again. So no wonder he's discouraged at the end of this passage. But it says in verse 14, then the sanctuary will be restored to its rightful state. Well, and we know, because we've read our New Testament, that Jesus Christ is God in the flesh, that he tabernacled among us, that the new sanctuary is the dwelling place of God built by those in union with him. And the greatest blasphemy was not Antiochus sacrificing a pig on the altar. The greatest blasphemy was the dwelling place of God, Jesus Christ, being sacrificed on the cross. Here's the point I'm making. The same hatred of God that motivated this evil king to destroy the temple in Jerusalem motivated Pilate and all those other rulers to take Jesus Christ, who was God's sanctuary on earth, and put him on a cross and sacrifice him. The offering to evil that happened in that temple in Jerusalem 200 years before happened in a much worse way when Jesus Christ, God dwelling on earth, was sacrificed on the cross. So that the same evil plays out again. And in the same way that the sanctuary was restored here, that temple that Jesus himself walked through, that was living testimony that God will raise up his sanctuary again even after it suffers persecution. So when Jesus walked through those temple buildings and he saw those stones, in his mind, he's remembering God caused his sanctuary to endure Antiochus Epiphanes. And when he said, if you tear down this temple, I will raise it up in 3 days, he was saying it's going to happen again. It's going to happen again. The temple is going to be destroyed again. But it's going to rise up again. And then in Jesus, since we're the new temple, we can apply to the truth of this passage what he says to Peter. I will build my church, the new dwelling place of God on earth, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. They will persecute, they will crush, they will destroy, they will perplex, they will deceive, they will confuse, but they will not prevail against it. So we look back at Jesus and we say the great temple was crushed and destroyed, but then he rose again, and in him there's a new temple that will not be prevailed upon. And that temple will last through 1,000 antichrists and probably a final great one that looks a lot like this until the Lord Jesus returns for his bride and we are established with him forever in that heavenly kingdom. What's the map that we need? It's the map that there's going to be people that hate God's dwelling place, that hate us, that hate Jesus. There are going to be those people. There's going to be those moments. Sooner or later, you will face those moments. I was just talking to a brother this week, talking about how people in his family despised him in many ways for how he was following God. And he's having to cling to Jesus. He was saying, you know, honestly, it's helping me. It's helping me to cling to Jesus. Because I realize even my family despises me because I'm following God. So I'm clinging to Jesus. We want to be prepared to do that too. To cling to Jesus. Daniel 8 was written so that God's people would not be surprised, would cling to their Lord in spite of the persecution and the raging nations they would face. And we need the same call and command. Let's cling to Jesus. Our great temple. Let's draw near to him with full assurance of faith. Let's have confidence in him. Yes, that persecution will come. Yes, the difficulty will come. Yes, that rulers will come and go. Yes, there'll be a people a lot like that little horn, but in the end, he will be broken by a divine hand, and God's kingdom will last forever. Let's endure. Let's be faithful. Let's study the map. So that we're not surprised, so we can be faithful to the Lord through all of those turns in the road until we reach the destination and see his face. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to express our absolute confidence in you, that you know the future. You know the name and the tenure of every king that will rise, of every nation that will rise. You know the time of every nation's decline. You know the moment of every leader's downfall. You know the exact length of every season of persecution. You know it to the day. How long that persecution will last. So Lord, we tremble at the potential of persecution and danger, but Lord, we trust in you. We receive from you this warning. Lord, we long for the day when you will deliver us into your kingdom. Help us to be prepared. Help us to be faithful. Help us to endure to the end. Thank you, Lord, that you promised you will be with us always, even to the end of the age. We rejoice in you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.